patient was a friend of mine. She's a nurse at the hospital, took care of both of my kids when they were born, and she came in with a parotid tumor. It was a much more difficult resection than I anticipated. When we got to the recovery room, her smile wasn't symmetric anymore, so my stomach fell down to the floor. This was a known complication. You know, this is something that we had talked about before. I went over the case in my head, you know, over and over and over again. You know, what did I do? Where did the problem happen? Did I do anything that was inappropriate or wrong? Or how could I have avoided this problem? You know, that was part of it. And part of it was just feeling miserable because, you know, I'd done something horrible to somebody I cared about.
For me, I still have a lot of work ahead of me to get through it, and I can't imagine what a clinician feels. Because, you know, the plan was to make something better, and it made it worse. And that's not what they're into doing.
Everybody I know has had some kind of complication or adverse outcome with some patient along the way, not necessarily through your own fault, but you're responsible for them and things don't go well. That's really difficult.
Most physicians don't talk about it. They just suffer.
As physicians, we see severe human suffering without treating our own soul.
Whatever uniform you put on, you're still a human being first, and you have a right to a good quality of life. Whether you're a hospital CEO, a thoracic surgeon, or you're working janitorial services, you didn't surrender your rights to be a human being just because you work in this mission-driven hospital setting.
Something has to be done. Something has to be done. How are they going to be caring for the next patient effectively if they're carrying this around with them?
As a chief medical officer in a large academic setting, it is our job to provide safe, efficient, high-quality care for all of our patients. And that care is ensured by a medical staff performing at the top of their game, to the highest level of their abilities. And anything that interferes with that level of performance is of major concern to me and to the institution, because it impairs to one degree or another the caliber of care that we're giving.
The thing that I think would have helped me the most was getting some degree of empathy, so that people would say, you know, this terrible thing has happened and we feel terrible for you. You know, I wish someone had said that, you know? And then, after that, finding someone or directing me in the right place where I could work out the feelings that I'm having as a result of that to get my life back in order.
Unfortunately, medicine has not done a great job of dealing with frontline caregivers' emotions. Ironically, we've engineered a system that really ignores a core dimension of human nature, which is the fact that people tend to have powerful emotional reactions to events like medical error and even to death and suffering.
When I was a fellow in critical care, I made a decision to take a breathing tube out of a patient, a decision that turned out to be the wrong decision. And after we took it out, we relatively urgently needed to put it back in, and that was difficult. The patient didn't get oxygen for a while and suffered a hypoxic brain injury. You know, fortunately, in the long term, they recovered, but right after the event, I remember vividly looking at the patient's wife, and she had tears in her eyes and was clearly upset. And I felt absolutely miserable. I felt absolutely horrible with no path to resolution because I, back then, and to some extent now, doctors weren't supposed to make mistakes, right? It wasn't something I was free to do. And so I couldn't talk about it. I couldn't either heal the patient's wife, I couldn't heal myself, and importantly, we couldn't use any of the tools that we know now work well to learn from the mistake.
I remember going to a senior nurse at our facility and just asking her, you know, for some guidance. And so I went home, took a shower, came back to work 2 hours later without any breaks, and said, well, I need to tell you what happened. And she said, well, welcome to nursing, honey. Buck it up. And I thought, you know, if this is what nursing's all about, this hurts too bad. I can't do this.
I don't think I ever learned a way to help me deal with the pain that comes when things don't always go right. I had a patient who was in his early 60s, very healthy gentleman, who was referred to me for another coronary bypass procedure. We picked using a blood vessel from his arm, and in the period immediately after surgery, that graft went into spasm and stopped functioning. And we had to rush him back to the operating room, and there were things that we could do to fix the problem, but so much damage was done to his heart that after a month in the intensive care unit, he went on to die. And it was awful. I mean, you can tell yourself on a conscious level, oh, it's their disease. Oh, it would have happened to them anyway. But in my heart, I knew for this patient that things might have been different if I made a different decision. And I beat myself up over it. I can still feel it today.
What can happen can be an array of problems from becoming anxious, overly obsessive, guilt-ridden, depressed, not wanting to come to work, not liking what one does, feeling stress that can come out in many different ways.
Immediately after this happened, I was in sort of a funk. Didn't sleep well. I wasn't functioning at my peak level. I worried about, you know, what was going to happen next. I worried about my patient. I worried about how I was going to deal with this. And I walked around sort of coping with each little problem as it came along, but without any foresight. Lost all my confidence. It was difficult. You don't want to just be left wallowing with your problem. I want to have people, you know, say, yes, there's a problem, and go on to try and make that system that comes into play afterwards be as supportive as possible, rather than being, you know, ignoring or accusatory or, you know, set adrift.
I think providers need to be able to have permission to say, I can't do it. I need to take a breath. I need to stop what I'm doing. I need to, and to get support from the chiefs of their service or the medical director. And that is not looked upon as weakness.
An
emergency services, we have a list of events that we work from, which there is national research behind, and a sequence of the worst to the least troubling. We assume, at least for the first 72 hours, that these are normal reactions of a normal trained professional to an event that even for them is outside the range of normal experience. We would say the same thing to physicians, as the military has found out. This stuff doesn't make your folks weak. It makes them fit for battle, emotionally fit to handle the next case. So I would argue, have those services in the hospital, make them available immediately. There should be no stigma or humiliation attached to them. In some cases, they should not even have to ask for them. Just as we took our material from combat stress and said, gee, is there an analogy to the street, from the battlefield to the street, we're trying to say to the hospital-based services, there is an analogy for you from pre-hospital. You have to adapt it to your own context.
I can speak only for Kaiser Permanente, and we've taken this duty very seriously since we are so closely integrated with our physician groups. And we know, particularly in fields like general surgery or primary care or OBGYN, where many of these kinds of events tend to happen, that clinicians are valuable, that keeping good, trained, compassionate, empathic clinicians who understand the risks of complicated systems are an incredible resource which needs to be nurtured and maintained. Understanding that leads to preparation and forethought about what might happen and the kinds of structures and training that need to be in place on a routine basis.
We realized that clinicians were suffering in fairly predictable ways. So as we almost saw it as a responsibility to figure out more about what's going on with these clinicians. It's termed the second victim phenomenon. So we did a qualitative research project where we talked with 31 second victims and explored their clinical encounter and how that was like for them, how they responded and what they'd like to see as a facility response. In looking at our research findings, we identified six specific stages that involve the recovery process for second victims, and we called it our trajectory of recovery. The first stage is chaos and accident response. Second, intrusive reflections. Third is restoring personal integrity, followed by enduring the investigation phase. Five is obtaining emotional first aid. And six is unique. It's called moving on, but the second victim can take one of three paths. They could drop out, they could survive, or they could thrive. Our program at University of Missouri works with unanticipated clinical events. The 4U team is a peer support team. It's a network of trained peers who are embedded in high-risk clinical environments like the helicopter service, ER, OR, ICUs, rapid response teams, code blue teams. And the peers are trained to identify high-risk second victim types of scenarios and surveil real-time to make sure that the clinicians are okay. Ultimate goal is for a clinician not to go home after an incident without some kind of support or guidance.
Our hospital decided several years ago that we wanted to roll out or develop a program to support the whole healthcare team, specifically around adverse events. Having a several-day training session to train clinicians and other healthcare professionals to respond to adverse events, both in a group setting and also a one-on-one peer support setting. It's a peer who I think most clinicians would be willing to reach out to. I think the institution needs to normalize the emotions that people feel. I mean, we're all going to have a different response, but I think there's some common feelings that go through a clinician's mind when bad things happen. And I would say that, you to know that other people have gone through this is incredibly helpful.
The Care for the Caregiver program at Hopkins is an expressive writing intervention that is designed for frontline caregivers to cope with the psychological aftermath of a medical error. And the ultimate goal is to improve coping strategies and to help build resilience for doctors and nurses. Expressive writing has a long and rich history in social psychology. It's been tested and studied for over the last 20 years. Results that we've seen for the program thus far at Hopkins are very preliminary because it's been used just in one particular ICU, but we are seeing trends towards a reduction in job burnout and a reduction in depression.
When I returned to work, and I had been speaking to someone in performance improvement, they were checking on how I was doing. I was saying how I never wanted anyone to go through this again, never. So she said, I got this video, you might want to look at it. It was called MITS, which is Medically Induced Trauma Support Services. And it was regarding a patient and a physician who got together and have worked it through and now have become national supporters of disclosure, apology, and recognizing that it's not only the patient who goes through things the clinicians are going through too.
The concept behind our organization is that when an adverse medical event happens, that there's support in place for everyone involved, the patient, the family, and the clinician, regardless of why that event happened. We can start acknowledging the emotional impact that hasn't been able to be addressed. When a physician is in part of an event, they've been told for years, don't talk to anyone. Little did they know, nobody ever said to them, you know, don't talk about the facts, but please, you know, if you need some support, here's where you can go. I've heard from many physicians who, unfortunately, they were in cultures that didn't allow for that. The wall was put up and they weren't able to contact, and they felt terrible about it. They were carrying that burden. So that's why I think it's important. Nobody needs to carry that burden.
I was determined, and against a lot of my family's feelings, that I was going to work with him through this. That for me, the way I could heal was to keep literally being around. And as the time went on, I realized very much how much he was impacted. I felt he was a good surgeon and physician in person. I didn't want it to change his practice. I didn't want to be the one that affected him caring for people, because I felt like he had a lot to offer, and he still does.
Our experience together is what made me such a staunch believer in trying to spread this message that you need to get support, both of us need to get support, and I think that that's the good that's going to come out of this. She said to me that she knew that I would never desert her, and I think that's one of the things that I got right out of all of this. And that, you know, I told her that I was sorry. I told her it happened right away, and I've worked with her since. You know, those are the things that I've done right, even though it hurts me every time I see her.